Generation Z describes those born between the years of 1995 and 2009, which places them in their late teens and 20s today. Like the generations before them, they have unique fashion, music, and trends that define them. This emerging generation can feel like a bit of an enigma to some people, which is why we have decided to check in with Gen Z in this part two episode from the original one that we recorded a couple of years ago. And so back by popular demand, and a big welcome to two of my Gen Z colleagues, Luke Davies and Holly Schaaf. Welcome back, you guys.
Thanks, Ash.
We're back.
Very excited
Thanks,
to be back.
Thanks for having us again.
Part two.
Everyone, I think, will be delighted to hear your voices and also to hear a bit of an update on what's been going on. We did this episode a couple of years ago. We were talking about this in the office. We were like, has that been a couple of years? And this episode has, I think, slowly made it up the ranks of our kind of most listened to episodes. So well done to both of you. And we would love to, I think, begin by hearing about some Gen Z slang. Let's just keep it light, keep it fresh, hear about some of the new terms that have come about in the last couple of years. So, Holly and Luke, take us away. What are Gen Z saying these days? What are the youth saying?
Yes, because Gen Z slang is ever evolving. So I feel like every day I learn a new slang term. But we compiled some that we feel like in the last year particularly have risen to prominence. So Luke, why don't you take us away? We're going to quiz Ash, but also all listeners as well. Give your guesses before we give the answers as to what these mean.
Okay, so the first slang term that we're gonna explore is to eat or like ate. So in a sentence, you would say, she ate, or like, what's another way of saying it? Like, I don't use the outfit thing too early.
Yeah, she ate that up.
Yeah, that's how you
they
use
ate
it.
That up.
They ate that up. Mm-hmm. What would that mean?
Mm-hmm.
I think you would know this one.
Yeah, I know. I do know this one. Not the literal term, like not eating something.
Never.
But I would say like doing something well. They killed it. She killed it. They did a good job.
Exactly.
That is exactly
so
it.
We defined it with a slang term that we used last time. So to eat is to slay or to kill it or to do something very well. So,
yeah. You could be like, they ate that presentation up.
I
feel like you could say that.
Mm. Or like, they ate and left no crumbs.
Yeah.
Is like just an expansion of that phrase to say.
Yes.
They did a good job and they left nothing behind. Like, they took no prisoners.
They gave it their all.
Exactly. Gave it their all, did the best they could do, and they slayed, as they would say. And closely connected to eat.
Yes, onto the next.
Another kitchen idea here. Let him cook. What do we think?
Yeah. I have heard this one before. Mm-hmm. I feel like is it kind of like let them do their thing, let them be who they are. That's how I think about
that's exactly it.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. I feel like that's exactly the definition of
it. It's just like giving them space to give him time, give him or her time to do whatever they're doing. Like whether it's a particular job or a task or an action, and they may look like they're struggling, or you may think that they need help. It's like, no, let them cook.
Exactly.
So,
yes, from a website I found that gives a bit of a definition to these things as well. It says both cooked and ate aren't all that different from understanding the assignment, another close one.
Yeah.
But it just means to excel. Someone may comment a Beyonce concert clip and say she cooked or she ate. Mm. The terms mean the same thing. In this case, that Beyonce did a good job. So next time you see a friend or a colleague doing something that they're great at or doing their thing, tell them they ate that up and left not one crumb.
Are you asking me to do that or the listeners? Next time I do a good job, Ash, just that's
yes,
what you need to say.
Exactly. Now you have that one in the back pocket. Pull it out. All right,
so
move on.
Gen Z have been in the kitchen. They've been eating.
They've
been letting them cook.
Yeah.
So, all right, Holly, what's next after that?
Well, now we have, let's move on to hits different.
Okay. I know this one, trying to think about how to communicate it. I think I know it. Hits different, like it's something special. It's a good job. Mm. It's something, that's what I'm thinking.
Yeah, I feel like that's pretty true.
Yeah. I think an expansion of it is, these are all very situational, is true. Something I've realized. So for instance, in this situation, to contextualize it, is the things like that moment, like when you're on holiday and you, like say you've been in the pool all different, in the pool all day, and then you like go to like take a shower before dinner. It's like those showers hit different because like you've been in the sun all day. You're about to go for like dinner at sunset. That's true. It's like it's just a shower. You're just like getting ready, but
it's
it
something
hits different.
Something special. Yes. Like it's
yes. It's just a very normal thing that it hits different in certain situations. So
yes, that is very true.
Yes,
more circumstantial.
That's one way you could use it.
Yeah, so. I would agree.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you're not far off. No, yeah. I agree. I have no further contributions to that. It hits different.
Next. Holly, you explain this next one, because it's not just one word. It's a whole ecosystem of use. It's a whole, like, what's the word? Like, syntax and lexicon of use.
Let me even see if I can try to explain this in a way that's going to make sense. But it's adding ing.
I-N-G.
I-N-G to the end of a word, particularly a noun. So coffee-ing. I was going to say light-ing, but that makes sense.
Yeah, the coffee is coffee-ing.
Coffee is coffee-ing. Sure. Exactly. Yes.
To emphasize like its action and what it's doing.
The plant behind you, Ash, is planting.
Yes.
That kind of works.
It would work, but if it was like especially like green and luscious and...
Yeah.
I know
one of you on this podcast is a Taylor Swift fan, and it might not be who the audience think it is.
But that's true.
I already know where you're going with this.
I have seen a lot of that. They call Taylor Swift mother, and they're always like, when she does a good job, they're like, mother is mothering. The context I think about with this song.
Exactly, That's actually the context that I thought of when I first like read the definition.
He did say that exact same thing when we were preparing it, so you guys are very in sync.
Swifties unite.
Yes, exactly. Making it very clear who the Swifty fans are in this podcast at the moment. But to give the definition that we found here, it says the suffix ing can be added to a noun to emphasize how that thing is performing well. So for example, the boots are bootsing, meaning the boot someone's wearing is good. Or the makeup is makeuping, someone wearing great makeup. It's confusing, but it's generally a good thing.
Yeah.
Is what they say.
So I feel like that's such a great strap line for like any new slang. It's confusing, but it's
more than often a good thing for you.
Yeah.
So if you're being told that you ate, that you cooked, that you're something-ing, it's normally a good thing. Take it as a compliment. Just say thank you and walk away.
Yeah, that's right.
All right.
On to the next. You're going to have to do this one because we talked about it and I understand the use of it.
Yes.
But I think you can probably...
Sure.
Do a better job, especially the like the genesis and the origin of this word here, like specifically. So
yes, I don't even know if I know the genesis, but I'll try.
No.
So it's something coded or something core. So it would be like I'm trying to think of an example. McCrindle core. McCrindle coded.
Yes.
Yes.
Generations core, maybe generations coded.
Yeah. Or like. Like Taylor Swift coded. Like if someone was doing something in line with like a particular personality or like the characteristics of something else, it is that coded.
That coded.
So, so for instance, if you're, I don't know why this came to my head, but if you're wearing like a flannel shirt, you'd be like, oh, that's very like lumberjack coded or something like that.
Exactly.
That's probably not the best definition, but it would just be when you are doing something in line with the characteristic of something else, it is coded.
I love that. Was just the straight definition for it, Ash. No guessing for you. Just got given the answer.
Yeah, we just
And these, I feel like some of these I have heard and have used actually, even though I'm not a Gen Z, controversially, I've been using some of these. But one of those ones I remember actually, I was in Queenstown last year. My husband and I went over there for a race that he was doing in Arrowtown. And it's this really cute, really quaint little town. And I remember, I think I put it on my Instagram story and I was like, this town is so Gilmore Girls coded.
Yeah,
it's like, just reminded me of that. It's that whole vibe. Like,
yes,
so
that's exactly it.
Yeah.
Used it in the wild. There you go.
Did use it in the wild. You're integrating it into your everyday life. But I think, Luke, you just explained what this said here, which is to be something coded or something core. So like Barbie core, for example, when Barbie is really big, massive movie, is to take on the traits of the thing that precedes the word coded or core. So, just something that you may see or like and be like, oh, that's very reminiscent of that thing, or it has characteristics of that thing.
Mm-hmm.
Is that, I guess, not much else to explain. I don't know the origin of it, though.
Yeah. I didn't realize that they were so closely linked, coded and core. Like, it makes sense. Mm-hmm. But yeah, they can be used in the
that's
same
quite
way.
Quite a big one at the moment.
Yeah.
Now we have, should this be the last one?
I think we should do...
Okay, two. We got two. Yeah, we'll go speed round.
I'll take the first one.
Okay.
And then you take the second one because you can probably just...
Great.
It's more related. Okay, so Roman Empire.
Mm-hmm.
And I think you know this one.
I do know this one. It has done the rounds on TikTok for the last little while. It's kind of like the thing that occupies your kind of spare time in your mind. You're always thinking about. Yeah. And I think it came about because there was this like trend online where apparently a lot of guys think about like the literal Roman Empire and
like every day
and all these girls were like filming the guys in their life being like, do you think about the Roman Empire, thinking like it's just some complete like not true trend, and all the guys were like, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so then like it was reappropriated. Is that the right? I don't know if that's a word, but
yeah.
Kind
yeah.
of repurposed now. It's like just for anything that you think about constantly or you wonder yes. about a lot.
Yeah.
That's exactly it. Like, great work. 10 out of 10.
Yeah.
Do you have anything else to contribute
to
that?
No. I think it's just my only comment is that it's funny that, yes, it was like one person did that on TikTok and then it just became a bit of a thing that you would ask like – either like a boyfriend or a male in your life, like, do you think about the Roman Empire? And then that turned into my Roman Empire is when this happened, or like a particular event or whatever it would be. So yeah.
Can I just say as well, I was so shocked when that was a big thing on TikTok, how many people do frequently think about the Roman Empire, unless they were just making that up. But I think you said that you would also think about it on a very frequent basis.
It was just a mass gaslighting of
everyone. Potentially.
Everyone just got on board.
Yeah, I guess so, because that just shocked me how frequently. I can't tell you the last time I thought about the Roman Empire, but since this has come up, I think about it more frequently. So you know what? That's it. Okay, last one. We're throwing this as a bit of a curveball, Ash, for you.
Oh, yeah, that one.
NPC.
NPC. I have actually not heard it or seen it used.
You haven't come across it?
No. Wow. Okay. It seems far too literal a use because this whole conversation, I think, is showing everyone how non-literal Gen Z are.
Yes.
But... the only thing I can think of is like not PC, not politically correct. That's the only thing.
Sure. No, that's fair. That's
the only thing I can like think of.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's a really good like stab.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
Also completely wrong. So.
It is. Yes, it's true. It's not correct, but I see. And I mean, it wouldn't surprise me also if Gen Z did have a slang for something of that nature as well. I feel like that would make a lot of sense. But NPC in this case, it comes from in video games. NPC is the non-playable character. Is it non-playable characters?
Yeah.
It's people that are just in the background that aren't the main characters that are being controlled, but like the side characters.
Just there. Yeah.
And so it would be the opposite of like what another Gen Z slang would be, which is main character energy. Which is that someone has something that it's just they exude, I don't know, maybe a confidence or they're so good at a particular thing. It's like, oh, that's giving main character energy for that thing.
Yeah.
An NPC would be like a side character in that. So someone who's not giving that kind of main character sort of energy. And I would say of all the things that we've talked about so far, this is probably one of the only ones that's like an insult. It would be like an insult to someone. Mm-hmm. If you called someone an NPC, it would be like... I don't even think of an example. I've never used it, but I've just seen it on TikTok.
Yeah, it's like the definition we've got here is someone who is so uninteresting that like it seems like they don't matter, and that's very savage. Like
that is
someone.
I know, and I don't know when people would necessarily actually use that, but I think it's more just funny because it's like NPCs are these. If you have a video game, they're just the people roaming around in the background that you see their face, but like they're just kind of move on.
Yeah.
And so I just think people sometimes will use that on the internet. So if you ever come across that, or someone calls you that, maybe don't say thank you.
I think another use is when if there's a video of like a crazy video of something happening in this video and there's just people standing around watching or just like kind of glazed over, like they would be NPC. They're just there, like they don't matter, but it's like this crazy thing might be happening and someone's just observing it. And it's like, oh, they're not even like responding or reacting to what they're seeing. They're just like
just
an
present.
NPC. Yeah. So
yeah.
Yeah.
That is a weird one, but
it is a bit of, it's yeah. quite niche, but we thought we might be able to throw you off with that one. So
yeah, yeah, hadn't heard it. So thank you for the update. Yeah, no, I learn a lot from you too on a daily basis, but also on public forums like podcasts. So no, it's great. It's giving Gen Z, that's all I have to say.
Oh, it is.
Well done.
It is good.
I actually say it's giving a fair bit in my life, probably because I spend so much time with the two of you. And my millennial friends are like, why do you always say it's giving? And I'm like, because I'm like young and like, and they're like,
I'm with
feel
it,
like,
I'm
yeah. and they're just like judging me for it. But anyway, moving right along, moving right along from the Gen Z slang. The other, I guess, aspect, it kind of ties into slang because slang can, I guess, be construed as a trend in and of itself. But since the last time we had you both on the podcast, are there any other particular trends that you've noticed among Gen Z that have popped up in recent times that you think our listeners might find helpful or insightful?
Yes, we have a few that we've jotted down and we'll just go through them. And so I guess the first one... It's not a trend as much, but just something that I've observed about Gen Z in the last, especially in the last year, is that next year the oldest Gen Zs will be 30. Have I got the math right on that? 994?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's right. Next year the oldest Gen Z will be 30, and the youngest will be about 16-ish. And basically just the fact that they're getting older and more responsible. And when I think I just realized this and it just changed my perception of, I used to think that Gen Z was still kind of in that end of high school, university, entering the workforce. But now we're getting to the point where, like, we're at the tipping point of the majority of Gen Z being in that workforce era, kind of like mid to late 20s. Mm. And that's just a really interesting place to be. Like, they're starting to get more buying power. They're just becoming more responsible. We saw in our not-for-profit research earlier this year that Gen Z are becoming more committed givers. So rather than spontaneously just giving to random stuff as it appears, they are becoming more regular givers because they now have, as we assume, a salary and commit to things because there's a bit more of a longer path ahead of them rather than that kind of sporadic period of high school and uni and like traveling and all of those life events. Mm. So I think it's just interesting that, yeah, they're getting older and more responsible. And just like changing that perception in my mind that they're moving through their years. So that was one thing. Holly, you had
that.
I think that's just an interesting thing to talk about.
So one of the things that Luke and I had just when we were chatting about this more generally, the cost of, you know, living crisis came up and that sort of thing and how that's a very prominent topic that we see within Gen Z on TikTok and all that sort of thing. But within that, I have noticed an increase in the popularity of dupes or replicas. And I guess to just give a bit of context around that, a dupe is like a version that a company might come up with. So for example, a makeup product that isn't claiming to be the exact replication of a different, potentially more high-end product, but it's saying that it's gonna do the same thing. So say, trying to think of an example, if it was like, say, a particular type of mascara or something in a makeup context, it's not saying that it is this exact, you know, more expensive one, but that it will work the same, it'll provide the same value, that sort of thing. Whereas a replica is claiming to be that exact product, has its branding on it, all that sort of thing. So dupes, I've definitely seen increase in popularity without a doubt when it comes on TikTok, on shopping sites. Like there's certain shoes. I know that there's a big viral shoe went on the Ganni ballet flats, buckles, and now so many, I'm literally wearing a pair of dupes right now. So I'm speaking from personal experience, is that so many brands started coming out with replicas of this exact look and not claiming we're Ganni, so we have this buckle flat and have the label and the branding on it, but the exact same design. Look, so many shoe brands have come out with that. And where I think that it's quite interesting and where cost of living crisis kind of came into it is that I feel like when I was growing up, or maybe just I guess earlier in my teen years as well, I feel like dupes, particularly replicas, but dupes in general had quite a negative, almost like social connotation to them. Is like if you're not going to buy the full priced high-end product. Why are you kind of pretending to be able to have it, or that sort of thing? It definitely had more of a, like, I guess, a negative social look, or just negative, I guess, connotations associated with it. Mm. But I've definitely noticed it's so much more common for brands to come out with these very evident dupes of other items and have no shame about it, and no, you know, and it's not, like I said, it's replica is different, where if it's coming out and it has their exact branding, so a replica would be like a Louis Vuitton bag replica that has the LV all over it, where it's saying I'm this exact brand. But if it's just the product, if it's the design, if it's, and you know, the there can be the style, yeah, exactly, yeah. And it's more about that which it's promoting. It seems that brands these days do not have shame when it comes to releasing even potentially things that's like, oh, that was someone else's creative ideas, but yeah. but so many consumers are really leaning into finding more affordable options to potentially, yeah, more high-end, inaccessible for them items, maybe for their wage. And so Gen Z, like you mentioned, Luke, are very much in the workforce now, making full-time, you know, salaries and that sort of thing, so can purchase items, but probably are not most of them would be able to consistently purchase high-end items. And so it's just interesting to see amongst Gen Z, particularly on TikTok, so many videos around, this is the dupe I found for this item, this is the dupe, and how that is actually arguably more socially favored than actually purchasing that original high-end item, because everyone's in the cost of living crisis and needs to do what they need to do. So I found that interesting.
Yeah, it's great.
I think the final one we'll talk about is something that it's obviously, this has been around for a while, but especially in the last year and a half, probably, is run club culture. So that is something.
The new dating apps.
Exactly. Okay. So exactly. You get it. So for the uninitiated, a lot of young people are joining or are part of run clubs. And so you literally just meet at one place, you know, assumingly local area for like wherever you live, and just running. It might be like 5 kilometers or just like some sort of loop, and you run together, and then you would like hang out and get to know people, and usually like have coffee and just like chat before moving on with your day. And I think this has been a really interesting thing to see. I like have started going to a run club. I've been a runner for a long time, but like have been going to a run club. And I think it's interesting to see what it is it's a response to the loneliness epidemic that I think was more spoken about last year. And I think it's obviously still happening, but it seems to, I feel like it's just in the public zeitgeist a little bit less. So it's a response to the loneliness epidemic, that whole mental health awareness thing. It has like the physical activity of like just get moving and you feel better, but also the social aspect of connecting with people, and just awareness of health and well-being in like a post-COVID world. I think Gen Z are just aware of that and like want to like keep. Should we just keep going, I guess?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. We'll crop that
part I'll just out. Crop that part
you
out.
You just randomly like stopped and we didn't hear anything.
Anyway. So you got to that out. You guys froze as well.
Okay, cool.
We'll carry on. And in addition to that, just, yeah, it's affordable in response to the cost of living. We don't need to, like, go clubbing anymore. We can just, like, go for a run and grab, like, a coffee. So there's just a lot of benefits that I think to see. And I'm in, like, the older cohort of Gen Z. And even when I go to this run club, I'm amazed at how many, like, younger Gen Zs there are. And it makes me, like, quite proud to see people who are just, like, trying to connect with people and, do stuff that makes them feel good. Like, it's so simple, but I think that's just another thing we're seeing among Gen Z that has popped up in recent times. So,
yeah, absolutely. Yeah. I've definitely seen the run clubs explode. And yeah, it's really interesting. I think you both kind of mentioned a few reflections there on the life stage and even like how their behavior is being driven by other trends like economic factors, like with the dupes and even with like run clubs are cheaper than gym memberships and like drink than going out for a drink.
The clubbing.
Exactly. The clubbing and 100%. Turning towards maybe more wholesome kind of activities and ways, which is really great to see. And probably characteristic of the fact that the generation are aging. Like, we're not just talking about 18-year-olds now. We're talking about, you know, people in their late 20s. Some might be countering the general trend and having children. Like, some Gen Zs are already parents. So I think it's interesting to see. And on that note, what I was thinking about, I guess both as you were both talking there, was as we think about the generation to come after Gen Z with Generation Alpha, it's really interesting, especially with regards to the dupe stuff. What I was thinking about was how millennials are characteristically a bit more like the perfectionist generation, even with regards to their social media use, or I should say our social media use as a millennial myself. It's more about like the perfect picture, and you go on holiday and you document everything. And we were in the era of like VSCO cam or VSCO cam, whatever, like you would edit your photos, and that was my generation. Whereas I feel like Gen Z now, it's just has swung towards authentic and a bit more real and not grungy, but just, more authentic. And it's interesting to think about the alphas coming after them and how they're probably exhibiting more characteristics like the millennials. Because what you were talking about, Holly, with regards to the dupes, right? I think it's fascinating because there's been a fair bit of talk about Gen Alpha lately and how they're kind of taking over Sephora and they're buying like these products and the, you know, with the guys, it's this fancy cologne. Whereas for Gen Z, who've got more like purchasing and earning power, they're turning to the dupe. And part of me is like, is that because the alphas are being influenced by their millennial parents who are a bit more about image? But also the alphas aren't spending their own money, but Gen Z are. So the alphas are like, mom, dad, buy me this thing. Whereas Gen Z in this economy, you're like, something's got to give in terms of like, if I want to have some goals, like I can't keep buying all these to keep up with the trends. And so enter the dupe, which allows people to still wear trendy things, but for less of a price. So it's interesting, but
so interesting.
All that is to say, let's talk about the alphas. Let's talk about the generation coming after you guys. How do you think Gen Z views Gen Alpha?
I'll kick off.
Yeah, you want to kick off?
So yeah, we were talking about this and it's interesting because I think my initial thought when thinking about Gen Alpha is probably similar to what I said about Gen Z. Just Gen Alpha are older than I had a mental picture of. So now this is the last year that Gen Alphas are being born. So the oldest are going to be 14 in like the next kind of 12 months. And yeah, I just had this image that Gen Alpha are all babies. Like they're all like under 1 year old. but no, they are moving through their years and they are entering high school. And I was recently just on holiday in the US and I would like see like a group of kids and be like, oh, like they would be Gen Alpha. Like I just didn't. But they'd be like, not by themselves, but they'd just be, why were they by themselves? I don't know. Where are their parents? But like the fact that they were just like it sounds like silly, but the fact that they were just like walking around, like doing stuff. I was like, oh yeah, like they aren't my generation. Like they are the Gen Alphas that we hear so much about, that we do so much research on, and that we, just kind of study and notice the trends of. So that's pretty my main thing. They've just, they are older than I had a mental picture of, so.
Yeah.
That's probably my first thing.
Yeah. And I think, I guess my thought when I think about Gen Alphas as well is I find it interesting to think personally about the context that they're being shaped in, which I know at McCrindle we do a lot of research on Gen Alpha and the generations. And so we like to look at those contextual factors, you know, social, economic, technological, all of these different contextual factors that are helping shape them. But I think, especially as I engage in social media sites like TikTok, for example, where there typically does tend to be a younger demographic who's engaging with that content, I do find it really interesting, and Ash, I actually think you brought up such a good and really interesting point there before about the Gen Alpha, like skincare, high-end sort of, those sort of trends compared to millennials and Gen Z, because I find it very interesting to think about why Gen Alpha, for example, across both of, you know, I think Ash gave it a bit of context there, but there's trends over the last year or so around Gen Alpha buying, Gen Alpha girls buying high-end skincare products, specifically high-end skincare products, and Gen Alpha males as of late being very interested in high-end male like fragrances. And I found that really interesting to consider how the kind of commonality across both of those things are the fact that they're high end and what is the reasoning behind that. And so I just find it really interesting that you brought that up before, Ash, is like, why is it that they are mostly interested in things that actually do sit at a higher price point compared to being able to find those dupes or those alternatives? And what are those factors that are shaping them, because this is the sort of content that I'm even seeing on TikTok, is these Gen Alphas being so interested in more luxury brands and just high-end sort of products, and what is the sort of environment that we're all being shaped in, but that it's influencing Gen Alpha particularly to have an interest in these things compared to even potentially more cost-effective alternatives. And that's where I think it's really interesting, Ash, you brought up the point of it's not their money. They're not the ones making the money yet, so maybe they don't have the, you know, the impact of, oh, I'm not going to go spend $700 on that pair of original Ganni shoes, for example. Like, I want to have the same look, but not at the same price point. And so I think there's that side of it where I just, when I'm looking at Gen Alpha, I'm experiencing, you know, so many of these things that are very shaping in the last few years, like COVID, for example, or cost of living crisis, different, you know, political, economic, social factors, all these sorts of things. But I think I constantly have in the back of my head, and maybe it is because I work at a company that does put so much emphasis on generations, but I feel like I'm constantly thinking about how are these factors impacting Gen Alpha? And then I look and go on TikTok and I'm like, that's so interesting. They're talking about that topic that way, or they're having, you know, interest in things like skincare and fragrance and having it be expensive. And I think kind of just to kind of tie that point up in that same vein when it comes to online presence and things, just how much more of a digital footprint they're also creating because they are so fully engrossed in this technological, you know, social space where TikTok, all their friends are on there, but they're not just engaging with the content, they're posting content themselves and a lot of it. And I think I look back at my old, you know, I have those Facebook memories come up. 14 years ago, you posted this really embarrassing thing that I wish I never posted. Now I want to figure out a way to go back and try and delete it all. But I just find it interesting to look back and kind of have that, oh yeah, I was engaging with social media, but it was relatively new. And so I would post a Facebook status, or I would post, you know, a photo, and it'd be embarrassing, but I don't have hours of TikTok content that's posted, you know, this whole massive digital footprint from my early, you know, 8 years on forward. I mean, I think you're meant to be 13 to be on TikTok, technically, something like that. But anyway, I just find it really interesting when I look at Gen Alpha as well. And I'm like, wow, I wonder if you're going to have or feel that same level of almost like embarrassment when you look back cringe. And you're like, cringe of like, oh, I can't believe I posted that or thought that was cool or that trend and all that sort of thing. But they just have so much more of it than I think we even did as Gen Z. So we're on the older end of Gen Z, I think, than we did back in the day as well.
Mm. And it'll be fascinating as I think, you know, if we just take a very simple, not all people fit into these kind of equations, but just for simplicity's sake, millennials are the parents of the alphas and Gen Z will be the parents of Gen Beta or Beta, who will start being born next year. So 2025.
That's crazy.
It's wild. A whole new generation coming through. But it's interesting, I guess, because I often say I feel like Gen Z were probably like the real generation to kind of just be thrust into the spotlight with regards to social media. Millennials, like I'm on the younger end of the millennials, and we kind of had social media introduced like towards the final years of high school and then kind of uni or TAFE or whatever, like when you're in your late teens, whereas Gen Z kind of had it from a really young age. I'm just very interested to see how that impacts even Gen Beta. Like, I wonder if we'll swing the other way, like the alphas kind of have the millennial parents who are still trying to figure it all out, whereas Gen Z might be like, no, we don't need our children's lives documented as much. Like, there might be more of a pushback towards that because Gen Z have faced it in a way that no other generation has, not even the millennials. So how they parent and impact the next generation. But you're right, Holly, I mean, there's the digital footprint is like, it can be funny and innocent, but can also be like pretty full on in terms of like how much people choose to disclose about their lives for prospective employment and opportunities and privacy. Yeah. And there's lots of implications, and some are like fun and jovial and others are like a bit more serious. So it's an interesting time, but fascinating to hear your thoughts. And I guess the other sphere that Gen Z really operate in a lot at the moment is of course the workplace. And there has been a lot of commentary about Gen Z and their need for praise, feedback, even coddling, like, oh, they're precious. Mm. Like, we can't use too strict, you know, leadership styles on them because they need that praise and feedback and encouragement a bit more frequently. How do you think your Gen Z peers view work and their workplace and their leaders? And what might be helpful, do you think, for people who work with Gen Z to keep in mind in light of the fact that you're both in this generation and you've got a lot of friends across, you know, different workspaces and things like that.
Mm. Yeah, I think it's interesting. I definitely see the two sides of, you mentioned that there's a high need for praise and feedback and coddling. And they can also come across as very entitled, like the whole thing of like they turn up, do their work, and like they leave when they want, as opposed to when like 5 p.m. And it's interesting because I definitely see that almost like the diva side to Gen Z, like they do that. And we actually have we have some research coming out at the end of August on intergenerational teams. And one of the things that Gen Z, I think one of their biggest workplace frustrations was their leaders' lack of ability with technology. And obviously, like, Gen Z have grown up with technology, and so just kind of a native to it, so that when they see an older person struggling to turn a Word doc into a PDF, they just like, why is this happening? Like, why? Like, and that's where that entitlement comes from. But I think it's specifically in response to the need for praise and feedback. I think what they need is constructive feedback, not for praise for their ego, but more because, you know, there's a lot of talk around like it being an anxious generation and imposter syndrome, and it's just feedback to make sure that they know they're doing the right thing. Like I said earlier, they're moving through their years, they're becoming more responsible, more like conscious of like what they want from life long term. So they want to know that they're doing things well in a workplace. So I think that was probably my initial thought of why is there necessarily this need for feedback? And it's not to say like every Gen Z has anxiety and they need this coddling. I think there's a lot of them who are just like very confident and just are confident in their abilities and know what they want and go after it. But I think, yeah, peppered throughout, there's this need for constructive feedback to overcome imposter syndrome so they can do a good job because they want to have a positive impact on the world. So that's probably some initial thoughts on Gen Z in the workforce.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I think just even going off the back, Luke, on what you said there, that was really great. And I think I totally resonate even with that kind of want for constructive feedback. And I think you had touched on it before, but I think there's just such, there can be very negative connotations with, or even stereotypes, I guess, over the generation with the negative connotations around the need for praise or the need for feedback because you need kind of, like you mentioned, ego, Luke, this ego, validation or kind of the need to show, oh, I'm doing such a great job. I need to be told I'm doing a great job. But I think it's almost it's looking at it from it's not looking at it holistically or looking at it from the wrong angle to see that as a negative thing or as a purely negative thing that Gen Z are just these entitled people that just need to be told they're doing a great job so that they can stay in the job and whatever. I think there really is within Gen Z a real drive for personal and professional development and wanting to be a better person and grow as a person and be and have that real drive and ambition toward like self-growth. And I think critical feedback is crucial to that development. And so I think seeing it as just purely a means to stroke their ego or just give them praise all the time isn't looking at what constructive feedback could actually look like. I think there's the encouragement of it. Yes, tell them they're doing a good job, but also say, you know, this is a particular area I see that you can grow in. And I would say, at least from the people that I know and that I'm surrounded by, that's probably what they're looking for more than just the praise, is that actual, like, I see this, or even I see this potential in you, but you need to grow in this area, in this area, in this area. And I mean, I wouldn't say everyone is a master at taking feedback or constructive criticism well. Like, it is tough sometimes to hear those things that's like, oh, I can do a better job at that. But I would say that with being a generation that it does seem like for the most part wants that personal and professional development, especially in the workplace, it is such a formative environment in your 20s as well. And like the way how you set yourself up in your 20s, I feel like really does define so many of the years after that as well. I'm blanking on the author, but I was reading a book called The Defining Decade, which talks so much about how what you do in your 20s, what you invest, the careers you're in, all that sort of stuff is setting you up for essentially the rest of your life. And so I feel like Gen Z, it seems like, really want to seize the opportunity and make sure that they're getting everything they can out of their 20s. And a big thing that, because so many of them are in their 20s, and I feel like a big thing for that is getting that genuine constructive feedback and criticism, not just praise, but helping them develop along that journey to set them up for the years ahead in their career as well. And so I guess it's maybe just, yeah, just kind of looking at it more holistically would be the thought I have on the back of that.
Yeah, for sure. And yeah, I think it's a really important one for people who lead, who are just leaders of any generation to keep in mind. But I'm reminded of our Generations Define report that we released last year and how every generation had a different ordering of the things they're looking for in their workplace. And for Gen Z, who, I mean, you both mentioned it already, like, you know, the oldest of the Gen Zs are going to reach 30 next year. So at this point in time, anyone who is in their 20s is a Gen Z. And so that defining decade is an important one. And I think, yeah, if leaders can lead and guide this generation with empathy, but also approachability and mentoring, as I think every generation who's gone before them has wanted in those early years of their career, but maybe how we do that with this cohort mm-hmm. of young people could be slightly different based on all the things we've spoken about today around, you know, the context that's shaped them. I think that's really worthwhile thing to think about. Final question. Is there anything else you think our listeners would benefit from knowing about your generation, Gen Z? I know it's a big ask for you to speak on behalf of your whole generation, and everyone, you know, has unique qualities as well, and not everyone might fit into all the characteristics we're talking about today. But anything else you'd like to kind of wisdom you'd like to impart to our listeners?
We don't have any like huge statements on like generic things that you should know, but I think my reflection of going through this and reflecting on Gen Z has been overall, don't be quick to accept the assumptions, both positive and negative.
Yeah.
I think don't be quick to assume the negative things are always true, but even that the positive things are necessarily completely wholesome and completely like vice-free, as if the good things are always completely good, which is just a critique of generational analysis in general, they are general understanding of things, but there are still individuals within the cohort that fluctuate away from the norm. But we hope that this was just a helpful, a fun but also helpful overview of Gen Z and just a bit of an update on what they're up to and what's been going on in their world. But yeah, anything you have to add, Holly?
I'll just add something quick. It was actually just a thought I had about the previous question that talked about Gen Z in the workplace, but I think can connect as just kind of, I guess, a final tip. More specifically, if you're a business leader or a leader of an organization or you're managing Gen Z, leveraging that constructive feedback sort of side of things where, you know, you're meeting one-on-one, you're recognizing that need for or want for feedback and actually using that to your advantage within an organization by actually investing into them in this way and providing them with that feedback so they can grow. But I think on the other side of that, Gen Z is very values driven and will want to stay in a workplace, in an environment or an organization where they feel like there's that value alignment. So I think I would even say, and I can say this within my own self and the people, my friends who are Gen Z as well, is it's having a very clear vision for and communicating that in a way that's compelling is very important for the generation to want to stay in a workplace. They are not just about, you know, the show up and do my job and that's the only thing and this is not connected to my normal life, like to my everyday life or whatever. There's a real drive to, I guess, make an impact. And we have, this comes, you know, all throughout our research as well that we do on the generation, is this drive for wanting to have an impact and have their work be more meaningful than just a 9-to-5. And so I would just encourage any business leaders that, you know, are leading Gen Z in the workplace, which I think would be for a lot of them true with how prominent they are in the workforce at the moment. But I just think really making sure there's a clear communication of values, of your company values, and how that actually is meaningful for the employee, I think is very helpful when it comes to Gen Z retention, wanting them to maintain their role in the workplace, is needing to feel that sense of, oh no, I can actually take responsibility for that vision, those values, that means something to me, there's alignment there, and I want to stay and remain in this organization, I think is quite big. So just keeping that in mind as well.
Yeah, and it reminds me of one of our phrases that we use a lot in our presentations, which is many young people leave jobs not because there is a compelling reason to leave, but because there is no compelling reason to stay. Mm. And we're talking about a generation who aren't afraid to move, and they don't probably have that same level of not that they're not loyal, but I think previous generations were like, oh, there's this onus on loyalty, whereas the workforce is so mobile now and change is kind of characteristic of the era that Gen Z has been shaped in, that they're like, oh, yeah, I'll change jobs. No worries, it's fine. And so, attracting and retaining them with regards to purpose and values is really important. And, yeah, I also loved what you said, Luke, because we are hopefully confident enough in our area of expertise and research with generations to point out the pitfalls of it as well. And, yeah, it does kind of come about through stereotyping. And I remember even with the Generations Define report, when I was kind of researching that and writing that, I was kind of trying to navigate this whole, like, how do we believe in this and use these insights and research to help people understand contextually people of a certain age, but also encourage people to not just assume they know everything about a generation or about a person because of the generation they're in. And I think if you're a leader, it's about knowing the individuals of your team and keeping in mind what generation they are, but also allowing them to be counter, cultural with regards to whatever the current trend or insight might be about someone who belongs to Gen Z. So yeah, some really, really great insights today from you both. Thank you so much for the chat today, Luke and Holly.
Thanks, Ash. Thanks for having us.
Great to be here.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or simply head to McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you again for listening, and bye for now.